about a classic problem in astronomy of how protoplanetary disks accrete, looking at some new clues from disk sizes and mid-infrared spectroscopy. But because I'm going to be here for several more months through at least the end of May, I was hoping that to share a couple of other interests that I have in the hopes that people who might be interested, we could get together and chat about them. So I wanted to share a little about the organization that I work for and some of my interests. So the organization that I work for is called NSF SNOR Lab, which was created in 2019 from the merger of the National Optical Astronomy Observatory, NOAO, and the Gemini Observatory and the Rubin Observatory. Altogether, we're the NSF Center for Optical and Infrared Astronomy. And as always, we're based in Tucson, Arizona. And our mission remains the same, to create and operate forefront research facilities like the Kitt Peak National Observatory shown here, and to create and serve data sets, as well as the tools that can be used to analyze these. And this is all in the service of the idea that anyone with a good idea should be able to pursue that idea using forefront research capabilities. So if you have an interest in how NOR Lab might be able to help you with your research, please reach out. So what am I working on this sabbatical year? Well, I'm looking at a couple of different things. And one activity is related to a white paper that I wrote with Arjun Day and other colleagues way back in 1999, several decadal surveys ago, where we predicted the impending need for massively multiplexed wide field spectroscopy. What with all the wide field imaging that people were doing in those days, very soon they would need some complementary wide field spectroscopy. Well, the future is now, and DESI with the dark energy spectroscopic instrument with its 5,000 fibers is working away at the summit of Kitt Peak on the Mayall telescope, surveying the universe and our own galaxy, as well as neighboring galaxies like the Andromeda Galaxy. And so Arjun and I are working with a couple of undergraduates, Gabriel and Josh, and the Milky Way science team too, looking at a new data set that's been recently acquired on the Andromeda Galaxy. On another topic, I'm following up on a recommendation from the ASTRO 2020 Current Decadal Survey that calls for a new model of engagement of how we interact with our local and indigenous communities. They call for something called community-based astronomy. What does that mean and how can we do that? I'm exploring that a little bit with two other undergrads, London and Andres. And all of the work with the undergraduates is courtesy of the Research Partners Program at Radcliffe. But my first research love is star and planet formation and star and planet forming disks. So today I wanted to share some of the results there. But before beginning, I wanted to just give one quick disclaimer about the nutritional value of this talk. Even though this talk is in the ITC colloquium series, the talk itself will contain very little theory and computation, but the kind of theory that involves the creating and solving of equations. So, not so much nutritional value of that kind. However, I hope that it will contain something about another kind of theory, a more general kind of theory, theories that are the structures of ideas that explain and interpret facts. So with that clarification, here's what I hope to cover. So quickly, a real quick introduction of disk accretion. What is it and why do we care about it? Then a quick introduction to the basic kinds of ideas that people have been thinking about how it might work. It's all about angular momentum and where it goes. Is it redistributed in the disk or removed in winds? Then some of the new facts that we might have been able to bring to bear on this question, disk sizes and disk dynamics. And then compare those ideas and facts, see where we are and what some of the takeaways might be. Okay, so on the first topic of disk accretion, what is it and why do we care? The reason why we're talking about disks is because when stars form, the material that they form from has too much angular momentum to just make a star. So the excess goes into orbit around the star in the disk, and material spirals in from the outer disk to the inner disk, making its way onto the star. And stars accrete a significant fraction of their mass through that disk accretion process. And while the material is orbiting in the disk, it has the opportunity to do things like form planets. The outcome of the planet formation process may depend on disk accretion. For example, we may see an imprint of that in the exoplanet population today. For example, we see many planets that are located much closer to their central stars than planets in our own solar system. And one idea is that these planets may have formed at large radii and coupled to the disk accretion flow and migrated in to smaller radii where we see them today. But disk accretion can also have a connection to planet formation at an even earlier stage. For example, one of the first steps in planet formation is the settling and growth, collision and growth of dust grains to make larger solids. And that process is assisted by a situation that has very low turbulence, for example. In addition, once we've made, say, pebbles, and we want to get them together to build planetesimals, the building blocks of planets, that situation, and we want to do it, say, through the streaming instability. The streaming instability is more efficient when the turbulence in the disk is relatively low. And once we've built our planets and our planet building blocks, it would be nice if we could preserve all those planets against migration so that they're not all swept into the star and we have to start over. So because of those kinds of questions, it matters how disks accrete. Do they accrete everywhere in the disk or just some regions? And does disk accretion naturally generate turbulence? And if it does, what parts of the disk are turbulent and to what extent? So we'd like to understand how disk accretion works just because in principle we should understand things, but also because it may affect the outcome of planet formation and therefore ourselves. All right, so let's say we're motivated to learn about disk accretion. What do we know about it? Well, one of the reasons that we know disks accrete or we think they're accreting is because we see accretion onto stars. So people have been measuring stellar accretion rates for a long time, and they can tell you that the stellar accretion rate increases with stellar mass, it decreases with stellar age. And the reason, the background of how those observations, those measurements are made, is simply that when we look at a young star, we see an excess, a UV excess of material that's falling onto the surface of the star. And because we know the mass and the size of the star, we can infer from the luminosity how much material is accreting onto the star. And for a typical young star, that's something like 10 to the minus 8 to 10 to the minus 7 solar masses per year. So we have an idea of the endpoint of that process, the accretion onto the star. But the question for disk accretion is how did the material make its journey all the way through the disk to eventually land on the star? So that's a problem that involves angular momentum, of course, because the material in the disk is rotationally supported. So it has too much angular momentum to fall right onto the star. And so it needs to lose or redistribute some angular momentum in order for accretion to occur. So two of the ideas are, one, that we could accomplish disk accretion through redistribution of angular momentum in the disk, where some brave part of the disk will be willing to take one for the team and acquire excess angular momentum and move to large radii, which allows most of the material in the disk to migrate inward toward the star. So angular momentum redistribution. And a different idea is angular momentum removal, where you can take angular momentum out of the disk, say in a wind, leaving behind lower angular momentum, lower specific angular momentum material that can then accrete toward the star. So here are two general ideas about how angular momentum transport might work. And let's have a quick look at how people have used those ideas to think about the disk accretion problem. So very close to the central star, within a few tenths of an AU, the disk is expected to be hot, maybe greater than 1,000 degrees. So hot enough that collisional ionization can generate the ionization that's needed for disk material to grab onto disk magnetic field lines and generate the kind of turbulence that can redistribute angular momentum through a process called the magnetorotational instability. And if we look at the disk atmosphere at those distances, we can even find evidence for superthermal motions that are consistent with the kind of turbulence that we expect. So great, we've solved the problem potentially for the first few tenths of an AU. The problem is for all the rest of the disk, including the planet formation region, where the disk is not hot enough to produce collisional ionization, we have to rely on external sources of radiation to do the job, external sources of ionization. The problem is that the disk is really thick, maybe it's 1,000 grams per square centimeter at 1 AU, and the external sources of ionization can only penetrate a restricted portion of that disk. So way back when I was a postdoc, Charles Gammy was also at the CFA, and he proposed the layered accretion picture, where we would have the magnetorotational instability operating in the whole disk in the very inner portions. And at larger radii, because of the limited ionization, we would also have turbulence redistributing angular momentum, but only in the disk surface regions. So we might have, in his picture, an active layer that's 100 grams per square centimeter thick on either side, where turbulence is redistributing angular momentum and materials accreting. And those two active layers sandwich a non-accreting dead zone. So that was a great picture. But over time, it's turned out to be a little challenging because the sources of ionization are less likely to be cosmic rays and more likely to be stellar UV and X-rays, a more limited kind of ionization. And non-ideal MHD processes have limited the column density over which this active layer is operational. So rather than 100 grams per square centimeter, it might be a much less, like 0.1. to 1 gram per square centimeter. And so if you imagine that by going to smaller columns, your accretion rate is correspondingly reduced, that means that it might be very difficult to use this mechanism to explain the known accretion rates. So theorists are very creative, and people have decided to use the same magnetic fields and the same smaller ionized region to transport angular momentum in a different way, using magnetic winds. So here we have the fields that we were focused on the fact that they might be turbulent, but now we're going to let them pop out of the disk and drive a wind. Now the problem is that these magnetic fields are pretty weak. So they can they have a small lever arm and can put out a relatively small amount of specific angular momentum. And that means that in order to remove enough angular momentum for material to accrete, we need to eject a significant mass in a wind. So if you like the idea of an efficient angular momentum transport mechanism, this really isn't it. Because if you think of this accretion flow as kind of like a train that's making its way to the station, well, here you are ejecting half or more of your cargo as sort of like your fuel in order to get to the station. But this is the favored picture. The other half of the story is that because you're ejecting so much mass, one day we hope that we'll be able to observe the ejected wind and show that it's actually removing the angular momentum that we expect. So this is our favorite picture at the moment and illustration of at least what some humans think is going on in disks. And we're not quite sure. So it might be a good time to poll some other individuals to see what they know about how disks accrete. We might want to phone a friend, ask a disk for some clues as to what it knows about how disk accretion works. And one clue we might want to pay attention to is the sizes of disks, because these can be quite revealing. And the argument here is very simple, that if angular momentum is being redistributed in the disk, then some part of the disk material has to take one for the team and move to large radii, which means that disks will spread and they'll get bigger with time. On the other hand, if angular momentum is predominantly being removed in these winds, then there's no need for disk spreading and disks can in fact get smaller with time. Now there can be some other processes that can affect the sizes of disks. For example, we could have photoevaporation that can remove disks from the outside and make them smaller. We could have some stellar or planetary companions that might form and also make a disk, truncate the disk and make it smaller. But there's not very many ways to make a disk bigger with time other than through this kind of angular momentum transport. So do disks get bigger or smaller with time? This is a relatively easy question to answer because there's been a lot of observations made of this in the literature. So the older class 2 or T-Tauri disks have been measured for several decades, their gas disk sizes. And more recently, the sizes of the younger class 1 disks have also been measured with the SMA and ALMA. So do they get bigger or smaller? Here's a plot that shows the gas disk sizes as a function of age for the younger sources in pink and the older sources in blue. And you can see that over time, it looked, while the younger sources are maybe 100 to 200 AU in size, the older sources can be equally small, but many are much, much larger, sometimes as big as 600 or 800 AU. So the much bigger sizes, at least in some cases, points to some kind of effective in-disk angular momentum transport going on. So it can't all be magnetic winds in the simple way that we imagined. So that's one clue. Another clue that we might try to obtain is to see whether we could have a peek inside a disk, not just look from the outside, but peek into the disk to see what kind of dynamics are actually happening there. Now, this might be something that doesn't happen very often, otherwise we'd already know the answer. So there might be only a special opportunity to make that kind of measurement. So with that in mind, let me introduce you to a friend of mine, one of my favorite stars, GV Tau North, who is a class one source in the Taurus Molecular Cloud. So it's kind of an older class one source, maybe something like the very famous HL Tau source that has the nested rings. And one thing that's really special about GV Tau is that it has a very unusual Spitzer spectrum. Its Spitzer spectrum in the region from 13 to 16 microns has some CO2 ice absorption, yes, but it also has these narrow bands of vibrational bands of molecular absorption of CO2, hydrogen cyanide, and acetylene. This is pretty uncommonly seen, but it is in absorption, but it's very much like the kind is the same bands that are typically seen in emission in more evolved systems. So here we have carbon dioxide in emission, hydrogen cyanide emission, and acetylene emission in most disks. But here in GV Tau, we see those same bands in absorption. So what's going on here? Often when we get to this stage, we like to try to figure it out using high resolution spectroscopy. So like two sabbaticals ago, we were able to get some spectroscopy with the TEXIES spectrograph on the Gemini telescope. This is a very high resolution spectrograph, R of 100,000. And here we're looking at individual resolved lines. So previously, this spectrum here is a whole band of molecular emission, but here with the high resolution, we're seeing individual lines of those same species of acetylene, HCN. Oh, here's some ammonia. This was the first detection of ammonia in disks. And because we're so excited by what we saw, we're able to go back the next year and get more data, where we saw a lot more ammonia and also water in absorption. So what did these data tell us? Well, it's really fascinating because the line profiles that we see are all redshifted. So here's, if we're looking at the system velocity in green, all of the absorption lines that we see are redshifted relative to the system velocity by something like 4 to 20 kilometers per second. And because it's just standard absorption, we can analyze them in the usual way to try to infer something about the temperature and column densities of the absorber. And when we do that, we find that all of the species that we detect have a similar absorption temperature of 400 to 500 degrees. And if we ratio their column densities together to infer some molecular abundances, we find that the abundances, relative abundances of these molecules are the same as those that are seen in emission in most disks. So we have the same temperature and the same abundances as material that's seen in emission in most disks, but the absorption columns are really huge. They're like 10 times larger than most than is seen in emission. So the same kinds of properties, but with large absorption columns and inflow velocities that are supersonic at several times the sound speed. What does this mean? But we're looking at it approximately edge on. So we see those same properties, but with a much larger line of sight column density, and the material is inflowing at a supersonic speed. So now we know everything that we need to calculate the accretion rate because we know the approximate distance where we're looking. It's the same property as seen in emission. We know the approximate vertical column density. Let's say it's a tenth of the line of sight column. And we know the inflow velocity. We put those numbers together and it turns out that the accretion rate through the disk atmosphere in this source is 10 to the minus 8 to 10 to the minus 7 solar masses per year. So a T-Tauri level accretion rate, the accretion rate that we usually observe falling onto the star, is being transported through the tiny, tiny disk atmosphere. How tiny is it? It's about 1/100 of a gram per square centimeter thick. So we have layered accretion in the disk atmosphere. Now you might say, that sounds a lot like what Charles Gamow proposed a long time ago. And that's sort of true, but also sort of different. It's still layered accretion, but the column is much, much smaller. So in the original picture, it was like 100 grams per square centimeter thick. And now the same mass is being transported through a much thinner region because the inflow velocity is so much huger. Okay, so it's different in that way. It's also different because while 100 grams per square centimeter is really hard to observe, we're looking at transport through the atmosphere, which by definition is the part that we can observe. So it looks like we're observing disk accretion in action. This is pretty unusual. We didn't expect to see this, and I don't think really anybody ordered that. And so we were kind of puzzled whether what we were seeing really made sense. And it took us a while to feel confident enough to actually write this up. So one year we were sitting on a bench at the Aspen Center for Physics, determined to write our paper and wondering what we would say when our colleague Xiaohan Xu came over and wanted to tell us about a paper that he had just finished with Jim Stone. And so maybe as a testament to the value of in-person interaction, it turned out that that was very relevant to what we're thinking about. So in Xiaohan's paper, he has a disk threaded by these green magnetic field lines, and the material is accreting in the disk surface at supersonic speed, at high speed. So the material is moving inward, and that drags the magnetic fields in, but they're still coupled to the disk at large radii. So now we have a torque where the material that's close in wants to speed up, but it is being slowed down, so it rotates at sub-Keplerian speed, which helps it to move inward. Meanwhile, the material at the disk midplane feels a pull forward, and so it gains angular momentum and wants to move to larger radii. The result of all of that is that there's supersonic inflow at the disk surface of several times the sound speed, so very much like what we had observed. So that gave us some confidence. But then when I looked in the literature, it turned out that there's some other circumstances in which you could get something similar too. It turned out that our old friend, disk winds, magnetic winds, is also predicted to produce this sort of feature in some flavors. So this is work that Xuning Bai worked on when I was last here as a postdoc, as a sabbatical visitor. And in the special case, or one case where you have net vertical field anti-line with disk rotation, you can end up with a supersonic surface accretion flow like we measure on one hemisphere of the disk. So there's actually more than one way to explain what we see. You can get these supersonic accretion flows either in the coronal accretion flow case that Xiaohan explained, where angular momentum goes out in the disk midplane, or you can explain it with magnetic winds that can remove angular momentum and also cause supersonic accretion flows. So let's now have a quick confrontation assessment of how the various ideas stack up against the observations. So we have our two ideas that we've just been discussing, the magnetic wind case and the coronal accretion case. In the case of magnetic winds, the angulamentum is going out in the wind that allows the star to accrete. Yay. Sometimes it can produce a supersonic surface accretion flow when the magnetic field and the angular momentum vector are properly oriented and you're looking in the right hemisphere. But because angular momentum is going out in the wind, the disk won't really get bigger with time. And so this picture can only explain some of the observations. Then we have Jahan's picture of the coronal accretion case. Here, angular momentum is redistributed in the disk that allows the star to accrete. Yay. It accretes through a supersonic surface accretion flow like we see, also great. And angular momentum goes out in the midplane, so disks will get bigger with time, also like we observed. It checks all the boxes, but the only flaw is that this theory is for ideal MHD. And we're pretty sure that ideal MHD doesn't really apply in the disk midplane. So that's a bit of a bummer. And obviously, even though we have some new clues to how disk accretion works, we still have a ways to go to figure out how it all fits together in terms of a real picture that explains what's happening. So as a human who would like to tell you a good story for an ITC colloquium, that's a bit frustrating that I can't tell you a better story right now. But I guess that's part of the process of doing science. And it comes with the territory, I guess, of working on these sort of classic problems in astronomy, which is maybe code word for very difficult. And so I wonder whether we'll ever really figure this out. And I was thinking about how that sentiment of the difficulty of understanding nature is captured in a poem by another New England theorist, Emily Dickinson, who begins in this well-known poem, "What Mystery Pervades a Well?" By contemplating the well and its impenetrable surface, its lid of glass that hides the mysteries beneath. And she ends up describing the difficulty of knowing nature and how the more you try sometimes, the less you may seem to know. A sentiment that kind of resonates here. She ends up being pretty pessimistic, you know, on knowing nature. But I think that's for our own situation here about disks, it's not quite so grim. Because I think there's some useful takeaways that we can, things that we can take away from the observations that are sort of independent of our ability to explain everything that we've seen. For example, in the poem, the lid of the well is an impenetrable surface that hides the mysteries beneath it. But here in the disk, the lid, the disk atmosphere, is actually doing something interesting. It may be where the action is as far as disk accretion is concerned, and it reveals more than it conceals. It also suggests that those atmospheres that we've been observing for decades may be doing more than just shining. They may be the major accretion zones of disks. And in that sense, they may be much easier to observe disk accretion than we had previously thought. Another idea that comes out of these observations potentially has a nice takeaway for planet formation. If we have the situation where we have a fast current, this fast accretion current, a thin current, overlying a deep, deep, deep quiescent ocean that contains 99.999% of the mass. It's a very shallow layer on top of 1,000 grams per square centimeter. Effectively, we've separated out the accretion function of the disk from the planet formation function of the disk. And that potentially allows for a very calm environment for planet formation, even at early times, because there's no need for that larger reservoir to be accreting or be very turbulent. That's really great for the initial stages of planet formation, where grain growth is helped by a lot of less turbulence. If we want to combine our centimeter-sized pebbles into the planetesimal-sized building blocks of planets using the streaming instability, this kind of low turbulence situation is highly advantageous for that. And if our planet building blocks and planets are forming in a giant reservoir of non-accreting material, that certainly helps to preserve those materials against loss to the central star. So potentially two hopeful messages for planet formation overall. And with that, I wanted to just sum up. So when we get to the limit of what we as humans can figure out with our brains and computers, it could be useful to phone a friend and ask for help. Our DISC friends have answered and they have given us a couple clues, maybe not the ones that we originally expected. It looks like disks get bigger with time, and that points to some kind of effective in-disk angulomentum transport mechanism. So not just the usual picture of magnetic winds. And disks may also accrete through these supersonic surface accretion flows that were kind of predicted in magnetic disks, but not really recognized as a potential signature of something we could try to confirm. So that's exciting, but the models currently, as I mentioned, account for only some of the observations, not all of them. We have some work to do. But nevertheless, I think there's some pretty interesting implications of these results for our understanding of accretion and planet formation. That disk accretion may occur in a very visible part of the disk that we had not imagined, and disks as a result may be largely quiescent, which is very hospitable for the formation and survival of planets. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks so much, Joan, for a super interesting talk. I just like to remind everyone to send through questions to me in the chat, and I'll call on you. And so just while we're waiting slowly for those to come in, I just like to ask about the plot you showed earlier that had the